I'm going to demonstrate a video that might be able to be used in an online live classroom setting, perhaps at a PTG conference. And this is the first of two videos. This particular script I'm going to illustrate is designed to handle one sound wave at a time, whereas the one I'll describe next will handle many keys. Okay, let's fire this thing up here. It's called online analysis, and one of the options is to save the files, so I have to specify that directory. I'll use this one. Okay, I'm going to have a recording window of 5 seconds, and within that 5 seconds, I'm going to pick out a wave of 3 seconds long, and it'll pause 1 second before the recording starts. And when I trim it, I'll trim up to 60% of the value. That shouldn't mean anything to anybody right now. And we'll start out with a nominal value for C4, although we don't have to use that. We can use anything. And we're not going to do the fine grid. Okay, so now I've got this screen here, and I got this little prompter up here. And it says press any key, which I will do. At that point, it'll prompt me to strike a key, and it'll collect the data. So here we go. Okay, you heard the beep. It prompts me to strike the key. I had a 5 second window to strike it. This was the way that it, 3 second wave that it picked out. And down here it shows the line spectrum. Up here it says press C or S. If I press S, I'll stop and analyze this wave. If I press C, it'll go back and try to read another wave. So let's press S. Okay, now I got my menu over here. First of all, let's take a look at what we got. Okay, there's the wave, amplitude versus time. You see it dies almost 90% away by 1 second. Here's the line spectrum of the whole thing. You can see I'm starting to get over here, starting to get the peak of the partial a little bit sharp relative to the harmonic, which is the red line. We'll do more about that later. Okay, over here are some of these options. Let's take a look at the tone center. Okay, here's the tone center. It says early on, the first half second or so, it's tone center is high relative to the fundamental, which is at 260 Hz. Now the tone center is the frequency about which the tone is centered. It's also called the spectral centroid. Okay, let's see if we can make any sense out of why it does that. We'll take a look at the spectrogram down here. Here's the spectrogram. Now we got some options over here. I'm going to raise the floor a little bit to get rid of some of that. See, some of the floor is going away. All right, that's good enough. Okay, you see what happens here. Here's the fundamental, and it's plotted versus frequency. So right down here, 261. And it's also plotted versus time. So it shows how the fundamental starts out and drops off. Here's the second partial, drops off, third partial. Let's go back and let's increase the frequency a couple of times. Go back and do that again. All right, now we got a bigger picture of the spectrogram. I'm plotting it versus frequency down here. I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 partials showing. And you can see that by the time we get out here to 3 seconds, the first partial, or the fundamental, is still hanging in there. A little bit of the second, less of the third, and these other fellows have dropped off. So the fundamental has persisted, and of course at the same time you've got a little bit of background noise down here at zero frequency. So as a consequence, the tone center is going to be high initially because of the presence of this strong component, and but these other components out here are strong initially, the high frequency ones, but they die off quickly. Pretty soon all you've got is this partial down here, and you've also got this low frequency stuff. So that draws the tone center down to the point where it's actually approaching the fundamental by about 3 seconds. All right, so that's the tone center, that's the spectrogram. Let's take a look at the autocorrelation. And it's going to prompt me for a signal here. Yeah, I'm going to say that it's 261 hertz is the reference point. Okay, and so now the autocorrelation allows you to ascertain the pitch of the tone by finding the location of the first and strongest peak, which is right here. And if I click on that, and then I back calculate based on this shift in time here, I get 260 hertz. Let's change the time a little bit. Okay, so that, now I've got it on a smaller scale, and I can pick that first peak a little bit differently. Okay, 264 hertz. So it's saying the pitch of this wave is around 260 hertz. All right, let's go back here. Tone center we've done. We're going to skip the fine grid line spectrum for the time being. Autocorrelation we did, spectrogram we did, line spectrum we did. Let's do it again though. There's the line spectrum. I'm showing linear power up here, and I'm showing decibels down here. And I can do something. For example, I can lower that limit so I get a better look. So I lower the decibels axis over here, and then I'm going to go back. Let's do that again. Yeah, now I got my pictures of my harmonics in red, and you can see as frequency increases, my partial starts to get sharp relative to the harmonic more and more. And we'll see that in a second again by another measure. See here, I'm sharp relative to the harmonic several hertz. Okay, to follow up on, see what else we got. Oh, you can do the cumulative line spectrum, which probably you aren't particularly familiar with, but it's the accumulated power in the signal as you plot it go against frequency. You start out with a little bit of contribution down here, which is this background. So you got about a couple of percent of background power. And then here at the first partial or the fundamental, you have about, let's see, we got 5 up to 75. About 70% of the signal is at this first frequency, which is around 261. And then at the second partial, which is around 525 or so, you have about, you say 10%. And then 5% here, a couple percent here, and then you get a little bit more at the higher partials. The autocorrelogram is the autocorrelation as a function of time, and it's more flash than insight. I'm basically plotting that autocorrelation curve that I showed earlier. I don't think it's still here or not. Yeah, there it is. Okay, there's the autocorrelation we did before. That's for the whole curve. Here's the autocorrelation as a function of time. I'm plotting time along here. Autocorrelation there. And you can see it's got that first peak here at about 3.9 milliseconds. So it's the same thing as this. And you can see that nothing much changes with time. That's not particularly exciting. Okay, what do we got back? Autocorrelation. enough. Okay, let's go back and read another signal. Okay, I'm going to press any key, and this time I'm going to strike a tenth. In other words, I'm going to strike C3 and E4, because several years ago when I took my class at Ithaca College, I was told that the tenth should have a certain beat rate if it's in tune. So I'm just going to strike two notes now and see what happens. So here you go. Okay, there's our signal. Oh, I should have changed the, let's stop. Let's go back here and see if I can change this. I'm gonna change the reference voltage. Let's see, the reference we have is fine. In fact, I can probably go to 1,000 hertz. But the reference point I want to go to 130.8, because that's for C3. All right, now let's go back and do that again. Let's take a look at the line spectrum. Okay, here's the line spectrum of those two notes struck together. Now see here, I've got the fundamental at 130, which corresponds to C3 that I struck. Here is the first partial of C3. Here's the second one in red. Here's the third one in red. Here's the fourth, and so forth. Here is the first occurrence of E4 at 329 hertz. And then over here is the occurrence of the second partial of E4, but also, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, the fifth partial of C3. So I have got my little doublet there. Now I can take a closer look at that. Let's see, I want to take a look at something that's centered around 657. I'm going to take the fine line spectrum now, fine grid line spectrum, which we haven't done yet. And I'm going to, what did I say it was? 657? 657. We're going to center it there, and we'll have a spread of 50 cents, and we'll do it linear, and it's going to take some time. It took some time because I can't use the fast Fourier transform for this to get this resolution. But now here's a picture of this, except I've zoomed in on this particular area right here and used high resolution. And of course I paid for it because it took longer to calculate. But here's my picture. And up here I plotted the power versus frequency in cents, 0 cents here. And these two peaks are separated by about, here's 10 cents, about 15 cents. But more importantly, they're separated by 2 and 3 hertz. So the separation of 5 hertz, which means that there should be a little bit of a beating going on at 5 beats per second because of the these coincident partials, or semi-coincident partials. All right, action. I think we've done everything here. Autocorrelation. Oh, I know what. Let's take a look at the autocorrelation of this double strike here. And let's figure we're going to have a frequency 131. Okay. Let's go up here if I can. Now see, the first and strongest peak is going to be here or here. Let's see what's. See, the first and strongest peak is going to tell us what the pitch is. So let's pick this guy here. 126. Let me get a better shot at that. Yeah. Let's go back. Refresh this. Okay. Here's the second. Here's the actual strongest peak. 65 hertz. So the first peak is 130. It thinks the pitch is 130 hertz, but the strongest peak is actually at 65. So the fact that we struck two keys kind of confused the autocorrelation. All right, so I think we've done everything we need. Oh, here's the spectrogram. We can look at that. You see, it's got a lot of things going on here. Let's get rid of some of the floor here. All right, I can see what we got going here. Yeah, we got, here's C3. Here's the harmonic of C3, harmonic of C3, harmonic of C3. Here's E4. See, it kind of dies away quicker than the others. And then over here is going to be that coincidence, which is hard to see because I don't have much resolution for this particular graph, because I'm using fast forward transform, and I'm also including the time variation, so it can't give us an awful lot of insight. Autocorrelogram. Okay, let's take a look at that. 131, that'd be fine. Okay, you can see here that the autocorrelation doesn't really change that much in time. So no insight gained there. And then here's the cumulative line spectrum, which has got all those components in one spot. So here's C3, harmonic. Here's E4. And then here's a harmonic or a partial. And then over here's this coincidence. Okay, I think we just about done. Oh, inharmonicity. Yeah, I didn't do that one. Let's go back and read another key. All right. I'm going to read C4 again. All right, there's C4. Let's stop it. Now let's calculate the inharmonicity. Let's see, first of all, we should probably change the reference frequency here. Put 2000 and then I'm going to say 261.6. Alright, now let's do the inharmonicity. Okay, so for that C4 curve, I plotted the partials in blue here. See the little blue dots? And then I plotted the straight line, which is the harmonics versus frequency. So I've got partials versus the harmonic. The straight line here would be where the partials would line up if, in fact, there were no inharmonicity. But because of inharmonicity, this blue line starts to get above the red line ever so more as frequency increases. And down here is this quantity, the partial frequency divided by the fundamental minus n. Now, if there were no inharmonicity, then this ratio, the partial frequency divided by the fundamental, would be equal to n, because the partial frequency would be equal to n times the fundamental. So this ratio would be n minus n, and so it would be a straight zero at this black line here. But in fact, it curves up. And that's a measure of the inharmonicity of this C4. And when we go to the next video, you'll see why that might be of interest. Okay, that's all I have to say about this particular software. This is something that we might be able to use in class, live, if we're dealing with one or two notes at a time. So thanks for listening and watching.